Instagram world. How's everybody doing today? Welcome back to TLT Talks, coming to you live from Casa de Lidvec, week number whatever it is in quarantine. Hope everybody's feeling safe and well and rested and thriving, taking advantage of the opportunities that are available to us. I'm very excited for today's show. Today's truly a treat. Mr. Leonard Steinberg, if you can request to jump in, I'd love to have a chat with you. Leonard, that is a question you're asking. There's going to be a button there that says request to jump in or request to join. Gonna wave to some couple people for now while we figure this out. Leonard, do you see a button that says request to join? There you are. And we are connecting. There we are.
Sorry about that. I actually did see the button the first time, but I didn't press it. And I think it's because I don't have long enough arms to keep this film far enough away from what's happening on my head right now.
Mr. Steinberg, welcome and thank you. It took us forever to figure it out. You know, I got to be honest, Instagram, get your game up because you do not make this easy. Like, why can't, it's my show. Why can't I just make your life easy? Why can't I click a button and just invite you on? Why do I got to make you do work? That's not very fair. Come on, Instagram, get your game up. Make this easier.
I usually prefer everyone else doing the technical stuff, as you can see. That's right.
Well, Leonard, thank you so much for coming on. For those people that may not know, Leonard Steinberg is chief evangelist for Compass. He's been in the industry for quite some time. He's literally, in my eyes, helped to build the industry and one of the most unknown people, liked people. You know, there's the million-dollar listing guys, and I hear good feedback and bad feedback, but literally, I've never heard a bad word about you, sir. And so I'm really honored to have you with us today.
I'll send you what I know. It's a long essay, believe me.
Oh, man, I love it. No, I'm honored to have you with us. I know you're busy. I know you guys on the Compass level have a lot that you're dealing with. And so for you to take some time out of your day, I'm honored. Thank you. I'm sure people are very excited and hearing what you have to say and your insights and your distinctions. I know I am. I'm always a student. Actually, when I first came to Compass, I don't know if you remember, but I asked you to lunch. We sat down. Yes. And it was a great lunch. It was like, Eugene, calm down. You just need time. You're already doing everything. And it gave me even more wind in my sails than
that
I
usually have. That was 2014.
Yeah. Yeah. Feels like, yes. Feels nuts.
2 weeks ago.
No. Anyway, so look, let me start off by being a human being first. How are you? How are you doing? How are you holding up? How's your health?
Besides my hideous haircut and my really bad complexion, which thankfully Instagram is kind to, everything is great. Nothing to complain about whatsoever. Zero complaints, actually.
Excellent.
And every time I think about the people who are really dealing with this pretty significant nightmare, I am actually unbelievably thankful that I am in this very fortunate position and healthy, and that's what matters. And
amazing.
You look very healthy. You always look healthy, but
thank you.
You're a few years younger. It helps.
There's a whole bunch of comments coming in that people love your haircut. So, you know, I know you know better than anybody else about taking in market feedback. So the market feedback is things are going just fine.
Things are good. That's, I mean, if you have your health, everything else is,
yeah.
If you have your health, you can figure out everything else.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. We've done a couple of these shows and, you know, my position has been like, look, of course I'm sympathetic and empathetic to the pain, the suffering, the financial loss for some, and, you know, the government's doing stimuluses and programs, but man, they're not making it easy and they have their own challenges. And, you know, for us, we're on the front lines. My wife is in the emergency room 3 times a week. And so, but still, you know, like a financial loss, like I get it's a problem, but it's a good problem. You know, not having your health, that's a real problem. You know, like
that's
so.
A big problem. Yep.
So yeah, I'm totally with you, Leonard. So again, thanks for coming on. I thought that
So Compass is all about helping everybody find their place in the world. You know, myself and everyone on my team, we're completely behind that mission. And we have our principles that I think are fantastic. For those that may not know the Compass principles, I'm just going to fire them off really quickly. Dream big, move fast, learn from reality, be solutions driven, one of my favorite, obsess with opportunity, collaborate without ego, maximize your strengths, and bounce back with passion. So how do we help everybody find their place in the world? It's through these really powerful principles. And so my question to you this morning, sir, is which of these principles do you think are the most relevant currently? Which principles do you think are, you know, people should kind of take with and run with, and not just Compass people, but people in general? Like, what's real important to hold on to right now?
I think all those principles really matter right now, but the one that stands out most to me is bounce back with passion. Because I think it's so easy to get a little bit drowned by all of this. And this is on a daily basis, if not an hourly basis, where you might be having a very good moment and then you hear something on the news or read something on your feed or news feed or social media feed, and it's just pretty depressing and sad. And you have to bounce back from that, because if you don't, you can head in the other direction. And that is something we actually have some power over. And that's the one thing I've been focused on most. Just bounce back with passion. You know, I'm not being Pollyanna about anything, but at the same time, I am trying to, you know, keep myself afloat here as best I can, because you have a responsibility to everyone else around you to do so.
Right. Any tips or examples? So for me, you know, I'm of the Tony Robbins family. So I'm meditation, I'm incantation, I'm rebounding, I'm working, you know, I have all my stuff. Any, if someone's having a tough time bouncing back, any suggestions, like what maybe works well for you? I mean, today, apparently the way to fight Corona is disinfectant, right? Like today, whatever. So
drink the Kool-Aid, but not the Clorox.
you know, every day there's headlines that even if we're feeling good in a moment, you know, can sink us. And so what are some practical, tactical approaches to bounce back that you think work well for you?
Well, I think the most important ones that I focus in on is there are a wave of things we have absolutely no control over, but we also have this probably much bigger wave of things we do have control over.
Right.
So I focus in on those. And the things I'm controlling is a routine. I make my bed every morning. I try to get out of bed by a certain time every day.
Right.
I do my memo to the company every morning. I make my calls. I have a schedule. I have a calendar. I have breakfast. I work out. So all the things that I have control over, I have kept.
Right.
And in that lies sanity, because that keeps you grounded, that keeps you busy. And everyone has always said in times of adversity, staying busy is the best thing you can do. Now, if you have kids like you do, you're automatically going to be really busy, but you're busy all year round.
Yeah.
There are people who are taking care of sick relatives, sick loved ones, sick friends. There are people who are dealing with emergency room scenarios. There are people dealing with loss.
Yeah.
All those things are, you know, very, very draining. So I do think at this point, everyone has to do what works best for them.
Yeah.
And I think the pressure to overperform right now for some people is unrealistic.
Yeah.
So as much as I'm trying to re-educate myself and learn, I have the ability to do all of those things. Some people don't. I can't imagine how you fit all of that into your busy schedule with kids.
Yeah.
And you know, a whole host of other distractions that really are unavoidable at this time. Yeah. I do, however, think that planning and booking those moments that keep some form of semblance of normal schedule is very, very helpful, especially for me. That's been really helpful for me.
That's awesome. Thank you. So if I can extract from that a little bit, and we've been saying this a bunch, is you've got to have a routine. Like you've got to maintain, especially now today, there's no more weekends. There's no more Friday night. There's no, it's like TGI tomorrow, you know, whatever. And so keeping some element of routine on our team, we have a couple people that actually we do morning check-ins. Like we all read your contemplation religiously. It's fantastic. For those that may not know, every morning, 5 a.m., Leonard writes it earlier than 5 a.m. or maybe the night before, who knows? Nobody will ever really know. But every morning we get, you know, Leonard's wisdom in an email, and it's invaluable. I know everybody in the company loves it. But yeah, you know, it's the same for us. Like, well, you know, we check in with each other every morning, some powerful questions, you know, a certain time, what time do you wake up? And we actually monitor all that stuff. But I couldn't agree more. I think some form of routine so we're not swept away. Actually, I was having a conversation yesterday as I'm creating a tool for business planning for our team. And, you know, some people have this idea that structure is confining, that it's like shackles. And, you know, the analogy that kind of came into play for me is lack of structure. A desert lacks structure, like open water lacks structure, right? That's terrifying to me. But if you're in open water with a compass, all of a sudden, it's a whole different experience. And so structure for me is a compass. It's I can see where I need to go. I have clarity, and with clarity comes energy. And so yeah, I mean I second that big time.
Oh, I think also without discipline, there is chaos.
Yeah.
And without structure, there is fear. Because without structure, you have to constantly be thinking about what is the
Yeah.
next thing you should or couldn't be doing. And that's tough. But I do think with any form of guidance from a calendar or from a compass or maybe a compass agent, you will have an easier path towards reaching the next step towards where you're heading. And I do think having that really has helped me tremendously in the last few
Yeah.
weeks.
Amazing. Anything good you're reading right now? I mean, I think it's really important. So Tom Ferry put out a I watch this stuff a lot. Tom Ferry put out a thing, Take Your Meds, Meditation, Exercise, Diet, Sleep. And I thought that was pretty clever. So I've been
There are
saying
other
that
meds too.
a lot. So anything, any knowledge, any reading, any insights or distinctions, anything you fueled your mind with lately that you think is a good pass to folks?
You know, I have been reading so much online that I haven't had that much energy left really to read a book as such,
Right.
which is a pity. I do have a few books that I've started and I refer back to them every now and then, but I haven't done any reading for pleasure. For me, the most reading I've done right now is for knowledge and education and understanding. And I've done a tremendous volume of reading around health, which I think is something we have to all in the future really become much more proactive about, because at the end of the day, one realizes we are machines, and machines need proactive maintenance. They don't need repairs all the time. I think we focus too much on repairs and not enough on proactive prevention. So that for me has been a big source of reading. Then again, I'm a huge hypochondriac, so that would, you know, fuel the beast. But the more you read about the coronavirus, the more you see extraordinary benefit in being proactive about your health and building this very phenomenal immune system, which for
That's
us
right.
as agents, I think, is as meaningful to be equipped to handle the very stressful days and times we deal with on a regular basis. So I think there's tremendous, I mean, the volume of reading and learning I've been able to do online has been breathtaking. And I think we need to compare ourselves to the people who existed 20 years ago, because remember, I was around 20 years ago. Maybe you weren't, but I remember 9/11 quite distinctly, and the internet was not capable of doing what it does now, not even by a fraction of a percentage. So the fact that we have this Encyclopedia Britannica in our palms everywhere is a spectacular gift to be able to navigate these days.
I actually just started. My coach recommended Time Warrior, and it's basically all about how time is not linear. I mean, I've been saying for years that no time is a bunch of bullshit, you know, pardon my French, that there's just we, you know, by saying yes to some things, we're just saying no to other things, and it's our choice what we say yes or no to. But Time Warrior goes entirely into the concept of how time is not linear. And if we look at time differently, anyways, it's really good. It's on audio, it's quick. And what he does well, he breaks it up into like 5-minute chapters. So it's just really quick, two chapters here, there, whatever. Leonard, I know you're gonna have to run soon. I'd love to ask you this question. I don't think there's anyone at Compass that can speak better for a Compass than you. So I'm just wondering, at a company level, can you share a little bit with how is Compass handling this whole thing? You know, what's their value add? Just anything really about Compass approach to this whole phenomenon.
Well, I think what is most important is that Compass is first and foremost focused on its people and the welfare of its people, number one. Number two, it has had to make big, bold, and semi really painful steps to be certain that not only do we survive this, because the one thing is we have no one has a timeline on this.
That's
So
right.
number one, you have to be ultra pessimistic in your planning so that you can really not only emerge from this year survived and strong, but also really well equipped to navigate the very exciting future that lies ahead of us. And while we are going through this, the kind of extraordinary aspect of it all is that we have the capacity to keep building that exciting future through everything that's happening in our tech and product departments. And that is going to fare us so well in the next 10 years, because I think Compass is very, very focused on long-term planning, long-term thinking, as opposed to the next week and the next month.
Yeah.
And right now, that has been as much a focus as taking care of the day-to-day issues that, of course, are very challenging. But we aren't alone in this here. Everyone is dealing with these issues, not only in America, but globally.
Yeah.
So I think the fact that Robert and the team have really maintained focus on long-term rather than short-term needs alone is very important. And we were first out of the gate, and we were first out of the gate to make difficult decisions. We were beaten up as well. We continue to be beaten up. But usually when you're getting beaten up, it's because you are doing things that are leading the charge forward.
I want to give you guys so much credit. I know we've had to make some tough cuts, like everyone has some, and my experience, the amount of communication and tools and distinctions being released, I mean, it's honestly, it's almost hard to keep up.
It's impossible to keep up. It's like a really big menu at a diner. You really wish someone had come in and edited down to 12 options. When there are 400 options, it's exhausting. But I think that's what's great about Compass.
Yeah.
It really does provide you this plethora of options, and then you have to decide which ones work for you. This is, by the way, the engagement with our CRM alone, I think, has tripled in 1 month, because people actually have the time now explore and evaluate what works best for them, what doesn't. And that is a remarkable gift from all of this as well.
For sure, my experience has been, I can speak for pretty much everybody on my team, has been incredible for whatever moves were about to happen. You know, I got a call personally from leadership saying, how are you doing? Like a person, I mean, there's over 2,000 people in New York City. There's 20,000 people globally. And like, there's still time. And there's still time to make a personal call. And I love that we remain a one big family, that it's not super corporate. And so real, real big kudos. I think if there's anyone to lead the charge that can get us through this thing, I don't know anyone that doesn't believe in Refkin. And, you know, talk about a guy that's not worried about bouncing back with passion. The only problem with Refkin is he doesn't really dream so big. You know, his dreams are kind of small. Leonard, I know you got to run a few. I want to go to the audience for some questions. What's the most creative thing? Here we go. What's the most creative thing you've done during lockdown? That's Sarah. You can thank Sarah for that one.
I think the most creative thing I've done is cut my hair. And as you can tell, I should leave that to the experts, because it's a real mess. I'm trying to make it look semi-respectable, but it's really rather hideous. And I really have tremendous respect for professionals who are experts in their field. And I think it really reminds me of how we as agents oftentimes relieve these for sale by owner people who come along. Like, I had no idea how difficult that was. That's how I felt about it.
You know, Leonard, again, I've said this to you, but we got comments coming in. Looks great, looks great. By the way, for those that don't know Leonard, that's how tough he is at himself with everything in his life. He's that driven to success. There's another question. Leonard, what your first day at Compass looks like? I guess after COVID, what your first day at Compass looks like?
What will my first day look like at Compass?
Yeah, I think so.
I think it'll be a transitional, gradual, new way of doing what we do quite, consistently throughout our careers, slightly modified. But I have to tell you what, so much of what I'm doing right now is stuff I do all year round, every year, but just in a different setting. And maybe I'm complaining more and eating more carbohydrates while doing it. So, you know, a lot of what I'm doing right now, the big difference, I think, is when we'll be able to have the capacity to show physically. That to me will be, it's the one joy I miss most in life is touring real estate and visiting with people during real estate. That's the one thing I probably miss most right now, besides catching up with colleagues, which I've done via Zoom now, which is good because it's almost auto Photoshop. And For me, that is meaningful. Right now, if you saw what was on my forehead, you would be amazed. You can't see it here. And it's like, it looks like I've been shot in one side of my head. It's terrible. So I'm loving these
Lennon,
virtual
if real estate
realities.
fails you, if real estate fails you, I'm sure everyone would join me in saying that you might be able to have a career in stand-up.
Preferably sit down. I'm getting a
There's a question coming in. Many clients are asking me how far do I believe the market will drop post-COVID. I'm of the mind there will be a huge flurry of pent-up buying. What do you guys think? I'm happy to let you grab that one first.
I think the price drop, maybe the maximum price drop, has happened already. And it's somewhere between 25 and 35%, because it's always the vultures that come out first and the opportunist buyers. And let's face it, vultures are a part of nature.
That's
When
right.
you see a carcass on the street, the vultures are there eating it up, cleaning it away, and then
Right.
what comes next? So I
Right.
think it always starts after a crisis with a trickle-up effect. Remember, the New York markets have come down dramatically in the last
Right.
3 months in areas,
Right.
not everywhere.
Right.
And also remember, we are in a hyper-localized environment in real estate, where what might happen in Chelsea will be completely different to Park Slope
Exactly.
at three different price points.
Exactly.
So how far the market dips, I think it's dipped as far as it'll go already. And now I think it'll trickle up, frankly.
Yeah,
I
same.
also think we've never ever experienced 6 weeks of zero showings ever. So when you have 6 weeks of zero showings, you are certain to have pent-up demand. 100% certain to have that. I also believe that if you look at Manhattan or New York City, September 10th, 2001, and compare it to where it is today, New York City is a much, much better, most extraordinarily different, wonderful city than it was back then. So these crises have a capacity to deliver extraordinary opportunities to improve things and actually make life for everyone a lot better. There were
Yeah,
a million trees planted since then, a
yeah,
million.
yeah. And I love that you said that because obviously we have a pretty big reach. We reach about 100,000 people between brokers, principals, and the number one question I keep getting is what's going to happen to the market? And there's no the market. There's so many condos, co-ops, townhouses, Chelsea, Brooklyn, everything's its own sub-market. And actually, Sarah and I put out a survey to, a couple hundred brokers, a similar survey that Compass does. And we talked about it last week, and we got that about 30% of transactions got done in the last 30 days from the contract price to the closing where there was no effect on the asking price, on the last contract price. So ultimately, there are transactions still happening. The world will go on.
Yes.
And I equally agree that, look, there's a little bit of pullback because of uncertainty, because people can't get out there and look. But at the same time, I think when this is all over, there's going to be such a hunger for bars, for restaurants, for touching and hugging, certainly for the markets, all of them, stock market, crypto, for real estate, for everything. Leonard, I know you got to go in 5 minutes because you got to call with Robert. I'm
I
going to
will
ask
tell
you
you
one
though,
last, yep, go
one
for
other
it.
thing I would say is, post-corona, the only thing that will definitely not change post-coronavirus for certain is the fact that everyone still needs shelter. That
That's
has
right.
never changed. It never will change.
That's right. Even if it went in the direction of recession or even depression, people will still need to move. Things will still need to
You have
happen.
to
And
live
we're going
somewhere.
to, yeah,
And how many
yeah.
divorces are coming after this year? How many marriages are coming? Babies are
Ha
coming after this year. I mean, there are going to be a
ha
lot of kids coming.
That's right. There's going to be a whole new boom, right?
Yes.
James Fierro asks, what are your top three must-dos in today's world as a professional?
Number one, you have to maintain your sanity so that anything you read, write, speak to the outside world sounds like you're calm and in control. That's number one.
Yeah.
Number two, you have to reach out to your audience. You have a clientele, you have friends, you have family, be in touch with your entire sphere, but don't talk to them about real estate unless they ask about it. This is not the
Right.
time. It's like talking to a widow at a funeral about who she's going to date next. You just
Right.
don't do that.
Oh.
It's the worst timing. You don't do that. So why would we do this under these circumstances? And the third thing I would say is try and brush up your skills as much as possible, because the
Yeah.
future of the real estate
Yeah.
agent lies in the hands of those who are the most skilled, professional, educated, re-educated, knowledgeable, insightful, and can provide real value to the consumer. Just like my hairdresser provides real value to my head, agents who are really knowledgeable and skilled provide real value to the consumer. And if we can deliver that, we will have an extraordinary, extraordinary future ahead of us.
Yeah, there's a saying that, you know, if you got to chop down a tree, something that's great sharpens the axe. If you got 6 hours to chop down a tree, spend 4 hours sharpening the axe. And, you know, education, reaching out to past clients, all these things are things that typically the real estate agent has no time for because they're so busy. And
I actually call the tree guy because the last time I had a chainsaw was on my hair and it's happening again. It's over.
Oh my God, Leonard, you're too much.
Well, I have to
start for 2024.
Unfortunately, I have to say goodbye to you and I have to get on a call with Robert.
Yes.
But I apologize to have to cut it short, but I
want to say thank you
so much. And Eugene, you and I have, you know, been together now for over 5.5 years. And I just want to congratulate you on all you've accomplished. You and your team are spectacular and you're still laughing even in the toughest times. And that to me is really commendable. So bravo to you, bravo to your team, and all the very best to you. I can't wait to see you and give you a hug.
Thank you. Likewise. Tell Robert to say hey and go do some great stuff for all of us.
Thank you so much.
See you later. Have a good one.
Have a good one. Bye-bye.
Guys, thank you so much for tuning in. God, I don't even know what to say. Leonard is just I find Leonard to be, I mean, forget about who he is in the real estate industry. I just find Leonard to be an exceptional human being and someone that's a model, someone that's one of my mentors, and I think he's fantastic. So the show must go on. You know, you heard it from here. Be structured, be organized, you know, use this time to sharpen that axe. If there's anyone that has a comment, a feedback, a question that wants to jump on for a few minutes, any brave volunteers, I'm happy to bring anybody on. But what I want to say most importantly, I mean, I just finished. I'll be going live next week, next Friday meeting. I just finished some of the business coaching I do is boards. I sit on 14 boards and they are ultimately my board members as well. And I'll report back what I'm seeing. Some of these people are global. Some of these people are local, all different businesses. And I'll report on what I've learned and heard back on. But the underlying narrative is stay structured. You know, honestly, I love that Leonard said, there's so much you can't control, but focus on what you can control. Like, that's a really big nugget. And ultimately, make sure that you're using this time well. This is, I mean, you can do Netflix, just not all day long. Like, my friends are texting me, oh, I just finished another show. And I'm like, dude, but that show is 7 seasons. Clara, sure. If you want to jump on, if you have anything to share, just request. And I'm happy to have a few minutes of a chat. Should be a request button to go live or to request to come on. Jeffrey, my man, how's it going? Anyway, so any questions, any feedback, feel free to message us, DM us. Clara, there's going to be a button to request to come on. And then once you request, then I can add you. Jeffrey, likewise, my man. I hope things are well with you. I hope you're safe. Doing all that good model stuff you do. Anyways, so Claire, let's link up after. Maybe, oh, here we go. Here we go. We are connecting to Clara. Guys, we'll go to 12:05. I want to be respectful of everybody's time.
Hey,
Clara, how's it going?
It's good. It's so good to see you. I was likewise loved you when I saw that you were going live.
Yeah, likewise. For those that may not know, Clara is a guru mentor over at Ninja Selling. We did a course with her, myself and James Fierro, and I've been in the business for 15 years, and still I left with so many knowledge bombs. Clara, you're a mastercraft at what you do, and I commend you.
Thank you. Yeah, no, and I just love what you're saying, and I came in a little bit late, but the gentleman that was speaking is spot on with everything he was saying. Now is the time to, again, work on your skill sets, sharpen your saw. The other thing is now is all about service. You know, one of the things that I teach a lot with my clients and people in my class is, you know, our job isn't real estate. Our job is service. Our job is a resource for people. And the more that you can do that right now, you know, you're just going to add more value. And we have to remember, you know, we want to position ourselves not just as their realtor, but as their trusted advisor. So connecting with them. What are some things that they need for their family to stay sane? Do they need some tips if they're working from home for the first time? But again, now is just a time to get connected. It's a contact sport. Have fun. But, you know, this time, everybody's using the term that this is unprecedented times. And I think we need to get away from that because we've all dealt with crisis before. And the message that I had today on my little blog that I did a few minutes ago was it's kind of like being caught in a riptide if you've ever been caught in a riptide in the ocean. You know, at first you're extremely panicked and frozen, and then you just have to take a deep breath and remember, swim sideways. Just take a deep breath. There is a solution. Right. And the ones that are going to survive are the ones that are really going to come from a place of value and service.
Any advice on what to read or watch other than Ninja Selling, of course?
Yeah, I mean, there's so many great books. Simon Sinek has always been one of my favorites. So
Simon's the man.
With Your Why, that's a great one. The Infinite Player, his latest book, is just incredible. If you're looking into leadership, he's great, but also Patrick Lencioni, if you're looking for anything on leadership. You know, if you're looking, Atomic Habits, because you had talked
Atomic
about
Habits,
the
James
foundation.
Clear.
Yeah, James Clear, that's a fantastic one. So I think those are some great ones to read right now. Yeah.
Awesome. What about something fun? You're home, you're quarantined. What are you doing to pass the time? Other than sharpening your axe, obviously.
Yeah.
What are you doing to pass the time?
You know, I'm just loving because, you know, my job is on the road. So needless to say, I'm not on the road right now. So I'm just trying to really have fun with my people. I like to be silly. So on Sunday nights, I have a quarantini party with some of my closest friends and family. Nice. So we get on, we have dinner, we have cocktails together, you know, doing stuff like that. Whenever I go out for a walk with my dog, I'm always talking with somebody, just connecting with them and, you know, doing that. I have dance parties, live dance parties.
There you go.
We were dancing to Prince the other night during his tribute party. You know, it's just, yeah, just getting out there. And again, just have fun.
That's it. I love it.
And
Clara,
keep
thank
active.
You so
you
much.
Keep active.
Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. For sure. Thank you so much, guys. I'm going to cut off. What a pleasure to see you, Clara. What a nice surprise.
Take care. Let me know
Likewise.
If I can do anything else for you guys.
For sure. Thank you so much. Guys, thank you so much, everybody. Any questions, any comments, hit us up in a DM, send me an email, a text, or whatever, Bird Messenger. You guys know how to find us. Next Friday, I'll be going on sharing directly everything I've learned, like I said, from these other businesses, from Keith Cunningham, who's been through, you know, 4 decades of business, up, down, all around. And so I'll be sharing some of the biggest takeaways from all those different businesses. Be safe. Take care of yourself. Take care of your mind. Take care of your body. Take your meds. Have a good one out there, everyone. Bye-bye.